Hello, my name is Bernd Stahl. I'm professor at De Montfort University, which is located in Leicester in the United Kingdom. And I'm also serving as the leader of the Ethics Management Work Package of the Human Brain Project. That's Work Package 12.4. I also represent ethics on the Directorate of the Human Brain Project. Now, in this presentation, I would like to give you an overview of the ethical issues and the ethical and societal issues that the Human Brain Project raises. Now, from the outset of the Human Brain Project, it was always clear that there were going to be numerous concerns that need to be addressed and thought through. And the complexity of those has led to the point where there have been questions about, well, what are those things? What do you deal with? And the subproject 12 has come up with what we've called an overview of the ethics and society issues. And in this presentation, I'm trying to give you some indication and a graphical help to understand what the various issues are that we deal with. So, the first thing, or the first set of issues that we deal with, is what we could call research ethics issues. So these are problems, questions, issues arising from undertaking the research. And most of those will be very familiar to those of you who work in this particular type of area. So the first one would be human research. The HPP collects data from healthy volunteers, but it also makes use of medical data, of patient data, and it recruits people to supply their data for the HPP purposes. Human subject research is well established, and people working in these areas tend to be well aware of this, but it's also a complex issue given that we have a variety of data sources and of contributors of data. The next research ethics issue is that of animal research. Again, the HPP has a variety of tasks that deal with animals, collect data from animals, and we need to make sure that we comply with regulation and legislation in this area, in particular the three R's, which stand for reduce, replace, and refine, of animal research. We have research involving human cells, which again is regulated quite strictly. So where cells are being collected, produced, we need to have approvals for doing so, and there are processes in place for ensuring that that is the case. And finally, there are issues around the involvement of countries from outside the European Union. And the European Commission, in their ethics guidance, is very keen to ensure that those participants are not exploited, that there are no risks to researchers, and that there's no research undertaken outside of the EU which would not be permitted within the EU. Now, in addition to those very well-established research ethics issues, there are some questions relating to the way research is undertaken in the HPP in general. So on the one hand, we have the question of research integrity. So this refers to the way that researchers behave during the research. It's supposed to strengthen the knowledge base by ensuring accountability and openness of research. And the Human Brain Project is bound by European principles, which are currently best expressed in the ALIA Research Integrity Code of Conduct. In addition, there are issues around intellectual property. The HPP clearly produces quite a lot of that. And there are questions around who owns what. What are the licenses under which data, software, designs are made available? And there is a potential tension between the requirement from the European Commission that open access is used, so that both data and findings are made publicly available, and the protection of intellectual property for commercial purposes. The HPP, as a large-scale data project, has a variety of issues to do with data. We have a data governance working group which has developed a data policy manual which attempts to cover the policies that need to be applied to govern the use, the submission, and the reuse of data within the HPP. And part of that after, and related to that are questions around personal data. So personal data relates to human data, so it's the flip side of the already mentioned collection of data from human beings. Where data is identifiable and can lead to or can be linked to a natural person, it becomes personal data and falls under privacy legislation. The HVP has to comply with this and is very aware of the fact that on the European level we are now looking at the General Data Protection Regulation, which is coming in 2018, and that we need to be able to comply with that as well. In addition to those issues that are more or less directly related to doing the research or the process of the research, it's also important to understand that the social and ethical issues are not confined to just the research ethics side, but that the HVP has the potential to raise significant social questions. One of those has to do with communities which are meant to use and benefit from the HVP. So how, for example, do we get modeling communities from the neuroscience interested in the HPP, and how do we make sure that they are integrated and their voices are heard? This has to do with openness and questions of engagement. In addition to these more scientific questions of integrating scientific communities, we of course operate as a publicly funded research in a larger societal context, and we need to understand and make sure that societal concerns of other communities, for example patient communities, are heard and considered appropriately. The HVP is set on a course to become a European infrastructure and therefore needs to understand what that means in practice, so how the milestones for achieving infrastructure status are achieved, and it can learn from the social studies with regards to how those things can be put in practice. The HVP has several sub-projects that look into the application of our neuroscience insights into technology, particularly in neurorobotics and neuromorphic computing. And these technologies, these brain-inspired novel technologies, may lead to consequences which are also worth exploring. So that refers on the one hand to industrial production through robotics, as well as to the questions of control or understanding of future development based on these new technologies that we should consider at this point while we are in the early stages of developing those technologies. And finally, there is a concern about dual use. Dual use stands for the military use of civilian research. And this is something that at the moment the European Commission, in particular in the Horizon 2020 framework, does not permit. So it's part of our grant agreement that we've committed ourselves to ensure that there is no dual use, which, however, at the same time is going to be a difficult issue. So how do we know what the consequences and the uses of the technologies and the insights are that we have? And we are aware that at the moment there are shifting views within the European Commission and the European Union more broadly as to how military research should be addressed. As part of that, the SP12 group is working on an opinion on dual use to clarify the stance of the HVP on this topic. We then have even bigger philosophical questions that go beyond the current social affairs and look into specific philosophical questions. So the human brain is the seat of human consciousness, which has been a hotly debated topic in philosophy for millennia, probably. So for us, the question is, what are criteria for consciousness, which is partly an issue of clinical relevance, because if the HVP is supposed to lead to understanding which can help people who have brain-related diseases, then of course questions around what are disorders, what are diseases, what are abnormalities of consciousness are important. Those are partly scientific questions, but they're also to a large degree philosophical questions, as they rest on our assumptions about what constitutes consciousness. A similar issue is raised with questions of identity. So how would we know what makes a human a human? In what way can neuroscience help us answer this question? And how does our novel understanding of the human brain, which is promoted and helped by the Human Brain Project, actually help us identify why we are the sort of beings that we are and what that means in practice? Now, in this short presentation, I did not attempt to give you any answers to any of those issues. There's a lot of discussion around them. We are doing much work within SP12, but also in collaboration with the other SPs on all of these various issues. And each of them is certainly worth its own video. The purpose of today's video was really just to give you an overview of the breadth of activities that the SP12 team undertakes, and to give you an opportunity to understand better what the types of activities are that we currently engage in. If you are interested in this, if you want to work with us on a particular issue, if you think we've missed something that is of importance, please do not hesitate to contact us, and we are looking forward to hearing from you and working with you in the future. Thank you very much.